KETV NewsWatch 7, chronicling the stories impacting our community. Stories making a difference. Stories that matter to you. This is KETV NewsWatch 7's Chronicle.
It all started with this ceremony. More than 5 years ago, the Archbishop placed an edict on the doors of St. Cecilia Cathedral. The centuries-old custom is the first step in petitioning to canonize someone. In this case, Father Edward Flanagan of Boys Town.
We see that in so many ways, Father Flanagan was ahead of his time. He had a great respect for the innate dignity of every person, but young people especially.
But the process to be named a saint involves more than being a spiritual leader. It is rigorous and challenging and requires the confirmation of two miracles. So where does the process stand now and what's next in this cause? That's what we're exploring today on KTV NewsWatch 7's Chronicle. Good morning, I'm Chin Doan. This Wednesday marks All Saints Day. Could Omaha one day have a saint of its own? The cause for Father Flanagan began in spring of 2012, and we've followed it every step of the way. But as church leaders have admitted, the process is long and complicated.
It's really the work of God. It's partly in the hands of us humans, but it's really a work of God.
But it could take, you know, in the history of the church, dozens of years, hundreds of years.
Good morning. I'll be talking with Father Flanagan's great-nephew, a member of the Omaha Archdiocese, and the man leading the cause for beatification and canonization. First, a few facts about Father Edward Flanagan. He was born July 13, 1886 in Ireland and emigrated to the United States in 1904. His first parish was in O'Neill, Nebraska in 1912. He later moved to Omaha and founded Father Flanagan's Home for Boys in 1917, and he became an American citizen in 1919. 2 years later, the home moved 10 miles west of the city to its current location. In 1926, the boys voted to change the name to Boys Town. A decade later, Boys Town was so well known, the cast and crew from MGM filmed a movie about Father Flanagan and his boys. During World War II, Father Flanagan was named America's number one father. That's because of the high number of men who served and listed him as their next of kin. After the war in 1947, Father Flanagan toured Asia to investigate how to help war orphans. The next year, he died unexpectedly during a child welfare mission to Europe. It was Berlin in 1948. Father Flanagan was 61 years old. But the legacy he started at Boys Town lives on today. 100 years after it was founded, the Omaha location is as strong and vibrant as ever. And there are Boys Town locations from coast to coast. Now, back in June of 2015, Catholic leaders sealed the evidence of his potential miracles. And KTV NewsWatch 7's David Earle was there for the Mass.
And it is here at the Cathedral for the Omaha Archdiocese that the last work locally happened to hopefully canonize Father Edward Flanagan.
The candles lit in the sanctuary as the procession makes its way to the altar. Sitting there on the table, the four special boxes containing the life of Father Flanagan.
You can imagine that we wouldn't go to all this trouble to collect this information and send it to the Holy See if it wasn't very good.
Hundreds heard the homily from Archbishop George Lucas, including longtime Boys Town director Father Val Peter. They all witnessed history as wax sealed the boxes. Also present, the bishop from Father Flanagan's hometown in Ireland.
The thought that was in my mind was if the bishop who confirmed him then only knew how the Holy Spirit was going to work in his life, wouldn't he have been amazed?
Equally amazing how quickly this cause for Flanagan's sainthood came together. The local investigation taking only 3 years because of the meticulous records kept by Boys Town, the place where Father Flanagan's work continues.
And it mirrors the work of Jesus himself and the commission of Jesus really to take care of our brothers and sisters. Occasionally we see these people that are sort of shining examples of that, and I think Father Flanagan has been one of them.
Now the proof heads off to Europe.
Not to Sligo, but to the Vatican, yeah.
And there is no timeline, though, yet on how long the process will take at the Vatican. In Omaha, I'm David Earle, KETV NewsWatch 7.
And joining me now to talk more about Father Flanagan is his great-nephew, Ed Flanagan, and also Steve Wolf, who's leading the cause that's supporting the sainthood effort. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning.
First, Ed, let's start with you. You are named after Father Flanagan. So what do you know about him? What has your family taught you about him?
Many things. First of all, it's an honor to be named after him. That was, you know, something my mom and dad decided when they were just got married. My mom would name all the girls, my dad would name all the boys, and he named me and my brothers after all his, after Father Flanagan's brothers. So that's how that happened. But things that we've learned, I mean, just it's a lot of the things that the Steve knows and a lot of the things that Boys Town knows, that, you know, he was a very holy man, you know, from the days he was born. I mean, he was, when he was first born, he was a preemie. And the midwife said he won't make it through the night. So he's been involved with miracles his whole life, starting with his own. His grandpa put him inside his coat, held him against his heart, and rocked him all night long with the fire burning and keeping him warm, and it got him through the night. And from then, you know, Boys Town is the culmination of his lifetime. And we were, you know, honored and lucky to be in that position. Yeah, I'm stumbling.
No, you're fine. I mean, this is such a big deal for your family. What would it mean to have a family name member be named a saint for you all?
Yeah, can you imagine that? I would have a lot of people coming up asking for favors, don't you think? Yeah, what an honor that would be. You know, as you said, I mean, we're seeing, you know, prayers answered every week at our prayer group meetings. I mean, that's the special thing about him. When we first started our prayer groups, we weren't getting answers. You know, we later on found that prayers were being answered. So. This really gave us a thrill and inspiration to continue on, and we've expanded them to every week, where it was just once a month before, just because of the enthusiasm of the crowd and the answer to all the prayers.
Now, Steve, for you, you are not related to Father Flanagan, but you share a unique bond. Share with us.
Well, I'm certainly a benefactor of his mission work here. I'm a Boys Town alumnus myself, and I can also, I think, kind of my renewed call to faith, certainly a result of having spent some time to really look at Father Flanagan and his motivation to really understand what he did, you know, he did with his life, and how he could pour himself out completely for everybody, all these kids, and have the global impact he did is very inspirational for me.
Share with us your role and why you felt like you were called to take on this position. It's a huge undertaking.
Well, I think the call actually came from the likes of Ed and some others that asked if I would help lead the Father Flanagan League Society of Devotion. It's a two-folded thing. It's a 501c3 because we do need to raise funds for the initiative, for the canonization effort. And also I've been asked to serve as the vice postulator, which is an assistant to the canon lawyer that's pursuing our cause with the church and at the Vatican. So I kind of wear both of those hats in helping to you know, help with the administration and logistics and the fundraising of the effort, as well as helping to correspond and get information and documents to the Vatican, to our postulator.
Talk to us about what that process is like between communication with the Archdiocese here and the Vatican.
Well, when you first start out on something like this, is such a rare thing within the Catholic Church, even though there, you know, over 2,000 years there are, you know, a few thousand saints, but it's a very rare area of our faith to work and practice in. And I kind of liken it to, you know, trying to get through the process as it's a mystery wrapped in a riddle shrouded by an enigma. But we continue, because of a lot of communication You take everything kind of one day at a time, and so right now we're hustling to get all the different testimonies that we received over alleged miracles to the Vatican. Getting ready, they're putting a position paper together, they call it the positio, and they're about ready to argue that case. It's kind of the closing argument for Father Flanagan's heroic virtue and his sanctity. So they're going to argue this case before three separate audiences of cardinals and bishops. And so we're trying to get all the last minute files put together on top of the things that you showed earlier of all the case files about his life that were sent to the Vatican.
Are you able to talk about the number of alleged miracles that people have come forward?
Yeah, typically most of the things that go on with the actual getting into the specifics of the cases, we have to maintain confidentiality and secrecy with that. But we have had 21 formal reports of alleged miracles. Two of those just came to us within the last month out of the 21. The cases involve, heart conditions. We've had the majority of the alleged miracles have surrounded brain conditions, which we find very interesting. But we've had people in different stages of cancer, different parts of cancer in their bodies. So we've had really an outpouring of faith toward this, and that kind of information that we're receiving is exactly what the Vatican's looking for right now.
Ed, for you to hear that a family member of yours could have been a part of all of these miracles, what is that like for you?
Yeah, it's impressive, isn't it? It just takes your breath away, quite frankly. I mean, I don't think it will clearly hit me or any of us boys from Boys Town until it really happens. But it is quite an honor, yeah.
And you're the insider here. What are some things you would like us to know about Father Flanagan?
Well, I think his holiness really started from the days when he was just a young kid, walking the fields with his father, saying the rosary, and looking after the sheep and the cattle. I mean, it really started when he was 4, 5, 6 years old, and he believed in the power of prayer like no one else, and in fact. Even petitioned the Archbishop to leave Boys Town when he was there to go be a Trappist monk, and the Archbishop said no. but this is how powerful he thought the power of prayer was.
And do you feel like, based on what I know about him and the health problems he had, and he had issues getting into the seminary?
Yeah.
Do you feel like that is what made him accept everyone?
I certainly could be the case. I mean, he was so far ahead of his time. I mean, not only allowing kids that couldn't walk and people of different races. I mean, he was 30 years ahead of Martin Luther King when he allowed, black kids and white kids and brown kids all to live together. I mean, he was a remarkable person, yeah.
All right, fellas, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Yeah.
It's been very enjoyable getting to know about his life through people who are a little closer to him. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Well, up next, we'll take a closer look at the process of beatification and canonization, including the evidence of potential miracles people have attributed to Father Flanagan.
I was diagnosed with 3 brain tumors. They did the test. The next day, he got on the phone and he said, "My God, they're gone."
More on that potential miracle and others when KTV Newswatch 7's Chronicle continues.
Father Flanagan helped me. He healed me. It was a miracle.
Dr. Madeline Leiniger, a retired nursing professor, was diagnosed with 3 brain tumors in 2002. She was told she had just weeks to live. Her doctor suggested chemotherapy, but Leiniger had a different idea. She prayed for help from the outspoken priest she admired as a child, and she says it worked. The tumors disappeared. Welcome back to KTV Newswatch 7's Chronicle. This morning, we're exploring the efforts to get Father Flanagan declared a saint. Those who knew him say it's his work with children that really distinguished him.
If you look at the lives of other saints, you cannot help but see Father Flanagan right in the middle of all that virtue and that sanctity.
And this past May, on the anniversary of Father Flanagan's death, a major announcement from the Vatican, a letter from Rome stating the cause will move forward.
This is important for the whole world to see what it is like to live a life of heroic virtue.
Steve Wolf says thousands of people worldwide are joined in prayer for Omaha's own Father Edward Flanagan. Wolf is the president of Father Flanagan League Society of Devotion and heading up efforts to elevate the servant of God to sainthood.
We've been very blessed that we've had a very dedicated group of commissioners and tribunal members that Archbishop Lucas appointed to the case. We had the great benefit of Boys Town having a very significant archive from which we could draw upon.
These special boxes containing the life of Father Flanagan sent to the Vatican in June of 2015. The Vatican has reviewed that case at the lower canon law court and have found it free of any error, and that Father Flanagan does indeed have the reputation of sanctity.
We're really looking at three steps before he might be called a saint. So the next step in this would be to be declared venerable, after a proven miracle, blessed, and then after a second miracle, it would be sainthood.
Wolf says there are 19 reports of alleged miracles by Father Flanagan.
In many of our cases, it definitely appears that there was a grace from God, that prayers were answered, but it wasn't something where there was just a complete inexplicable outcome.
And joining me now to talk more about the process is Father Ryan Lewis from the Omaha Archdiocese. Father Lewis, thanks for joining
us this
morning.
Good morning, Jen. How are you?
Doing great, thank you. Yeah. Now talk about your role in this process. Very complicated.
Yeah, so back in 2012, when Archbishop Lucas opened the formal cause for Father's canonization, he appointed me as his delegate. So I've been in charge of the day-to-day canonical ongoings with regard to the cause. The first phase that began in March of 2012 was what we call the diocesan or the local phase. And what that did was put together through a historical commission and a theological commission, a real thorough and complete look into his life. And then that was forwarded in 2015 to the Vatican. And that sits there now. And that's the good news that we got just back in May, namely that they had looked through our entire dossier. And as you saw, it was stacks and stacks of information, interviews and biographical information and theological, a deep theological look into his life. And the Vatican said that all of our work that we had done here locally in Omaha was excellent, well prepared, and done the right way according to canonical procedure. So that was a big and an important step, as Steve Wolf pointed out, because that tells us that all the work we've done so far has been good. Everything is pointing toward Father's eventual canonization, and now other phases of the process are going on, specifically looking for potential miracles that, if attributed and confirmed by Rome, would be then potentially helpful as we move forward. Rome, when we hear back from Rome, the next step would be making Father Flanagan venerable, and then again we're really looking for miracles, and then one approved miracle, he could be beatified, and then with a second miracle, he could be canonized.
Talk to us about, all the investigation you have to do, and is there a deadline or a timeline in which people can come forward?
Not at all. And so the League Society of Devotion for years has been encouraging people to come forward to bring their stories of potential alleged miracles, which may or may not be authenticated. An individual in a unique trial has to take place, really putting each of those potential miracles on trial, if we think there's enough evidence to warrant opening a trial on a potential miracle. Where these happen depends on where the alleged miracle happened. If it was here in Omaha, our tribunal, I'd have more work to do on my plate. If it happened somewhere else, that diocese, wherever it happened, would investigate that miracle. The thinking being the people locally on the scene are best able to investigate thoroughly.
So some people may be wondering, why aren't the people who are coming forward with these potential miracles here sitting and interviewing with us?
So the process is secret. We invite folks who participate in the process to keep it very confidential. It's under pontifical secret. In Omaha a few years back, we investigated a miracle that was approved and led to the canonization of St. Jean Jugan. I was part of that process too, which started in 2005. And we, for 4 years, had to keep the entire thing completely secret. until we heard back from Rome that they had approved the alleged miracle, and then that led to Blessed Jean Jagan at that time becoming Saint Jean Jagan, and that was back in 2009.
Wow. I mean, how exciting would it be to have an American saint and one here who spent so much time in Omaha?
Well, a couple of things, Chin. As a priest, what a shot in the arm to us priests if one of our own was canonized, an Omaha priest, a priest who worked with children and did so in an exemplary way. I mean, I think that's very, very important in light of the crises we've had in the Catholic Church to really hold up Father Flanagan as a model. So I think there's some real key components, and the fact that everything in Father's biography, everything that we looked at pointed to sainthood and sanctity. There was just nothing. He lived the life of virtues par excellence. I often say I learned two things in this process. I'm pretty sure Father Ed Flanagan's a saint, and I'm pretty sure I've got a long ways to go. But that's really true. So I think some of those things are going to make the Vatican really interested in lifting this American priest who worked with children and who did so in a saintly manner. He would be a wonderful shot in the arm for the Flanagan family, for Boys Town, but for priests in a special way.
And do you feel like even though this is obviously a very complex process, the simple takeaway is that we are called to be saints.
Absolutely.
And anybody can walk in that path.
And a contemporary priest in the American context is called to sanctity, and it's not something that just really old people or people who lived hundreds of years ago. We're called today to be saints and lifting up, and St. John Paul II was another modern saint, to use an example. He was really big on that, to call forward men and women who lived the faith out in a heroic way, but in the contemporary context, that sanctity is something for today. It's not just something from a long time ago.
Absolutely. Now, we have a video that we want to show you. It's pretty interesting. The Father Flanagan League, a couple years ago, went to Ireland and interviewed a priest from Father Flanagan's hometown. And during that interview, something fantastic happens. Let's show you.
Father Flanagan would be someone who's plowing another furrow and an inspiration. And we're hoping for the whole church, not just for Ireland, because we really need good news in that whole area of the dignity of the person, be they children or adults.
Father Lewis, did you notice something?
I did. It auto-focused on the crucifix.
Specifically the word dignity. What do you think about that?
I love it, because he was all about the dignity of every human being, especially young people. And boy, ahead of his time, really a gifted person to point out that every human being, and he was at a time when these homeless boys or orphaned children weren't really treated very well by society in general, and he really came along at an amazing time, and the dignity and the worth of every human being as made in God's image and likeness, that was his life, and that should be the life of every priest and all of us who carry the name Christian, but he did it in an exemplary way.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for
your
time.
You're welcome, Chin.
Thank
you.
We'll be right back with some final thoughts. First, a reminder that your comments are an important part of this show. If you want to be heard, email your comments to news@ktv.com. Remember, we love hearing from you, and we'll be right back. You're watching KTV Newswatch 7's Chronicle. This morning, we've been talking about the efforts to declare Boys Town founder Father Edward Flanagan a saint. It's a process, as we heard, that could take years, even decades. Now, if you missed any part of this show or would like to watch the chronicle we did on Boys Town 100th anniversary, both are online right now at ktv.com. Just go to our homepage and click on the menu button, then look for Chronicle. I'm Chin Doan. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you back here next Sunday morning for KTV Newswatch 7's Chronicle. He's already a saint in the eyes of many, but getting declared a saint in the Catholic Church takes the patience of a saint. This morning on Chronicle, we're taking an in-depth look at the process of beatification and canonization for Boys Town founder Father Edward Flanagan. His great-nephew shares stories about his famous uncle. Plus, we're talking to a representative of the Omaha Archdiocese and the man leading the sainthood effort. Be sure to join us for the Enlightening Chronicle this morning at 10, right here on KTV.